So it's 6:30. We will start with a great lecture from Spandana. Spandana is, I think, second pediatrician who has opted for palliative medicine. She is a pediatrician and she is working as a palliative care physician in Hyderabad, Pain Relief and Palliative Care Society, Hyderabad. Personally, I have seen Spandana so many times in the various platforms, mainly on eco platforms. She is extremely meticulous and I have seen her always very, very, very punctual and very disciplined. So Spandana, everyone is there. Already 30, 35 to 40 people have joined. In spite of holy celebration today, it's a main holiday. But everyone, this shows that how many people wants to hear you. And please go ahead with your lectures. Dr. Spandana, please go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am. Good morning. Hello, everyone. It's wonderful to see you all. And as ma'am said, on a holy day, you have all joined this early in the morning. So welcome and happy holy, everyone. I'll be sharing my screen now. And just a second. So the talk that was given to me was to speak about the practical aspects of setting up a pediatric palliative care service in a cancer setting hospital. And here I hope to cover some very specific pediatric palliative care points. And also while discussing the journey of pediatric palliative care at MNJ Cancer Hospital, Hyderabad, and more specifically in general, the pediatric palliative care program in Hyderabad. And also I have a small disclaimer to make. I know this is not a complete as a practical aspect sometimes, and this is very dynamic and ever evolving. So I would very much encourage you people to type your questions in the chat and give any feedback that you have. And I would be very happy to take any kind of feedback to improve the program that we already have. So first, I would like to start my presentation with a paper published in 2018, and this was by Stefan and Edward, and both of them are from the US. I know this is a bit of a busy slide, but I thought having everything on one slide would help us understand more about what they're trying to say. They say any program, I think they mean pediatric palliative care program, but I think they meant any palliative care program goes through four stages of evolving. And it does not necessarily mean that one after the other come, but sometimes all of them exist at the same time in the same program when you're interacting with different people. And the first one is denial. And by denial, what they mean is our clinical colleagues in the hospital, sometimes even the administration of the hospital, are going to say, oh, but we don't need palliative care kind of thing. And for this, again, doing surveys to document the unmet needs and sometimes even taking testimonials by a written and also by videos go a long way in convincing them that palliative care is needed at that juncture. And the next stage they talk about is palliphobia, where everyone recognizes that there is a problem. They have crossed the denial phase and they have this recognition that yes, we need pediatric palliative care, but then they sometimes feel that why do we need a new team, right? Like, we do good pain management, we good do good symptom assessment, and they feel that their professional competence is being questioned. And I think this is where we have to find supporters and mentors in our colleagues. And also we should keep collecting data that the impact we have on these children. And we have to show it to them. And that is one way to deal with the palliphobia. Right? And then is the pallilalia, where everyone is talking about how wonderful palliative care is, but then there is no funding and they don't give any enough time or at the place at the big table. And sorry, thank you. And this is the time where we have to use some benchmarks for the time, for the clinical time that we do and the impact that we have, so that we can fairly compare with our counterparts. Again, here we have to keep robust data on the referrals we are getting, the training we are doing, the research we are doing, so that we keep convincing the administration that it is much needed. And the fourth stage that they talk about is the palliative stage. And here, again, we have to remember where this is where we talk about the ideal situation where everyone is on board and where everyone is talking about palliative care and accepted palliative care. And we are given, you know, space, a formal curriculum, and also even medical trainees are rotating with us. So these are the four stages. As I said, these necessarily don't have to follow each other. And on a daily basis, I think all of you agree that in our different colleagues, we see different stages of this. One day they are in denial, one day they're supporting us, and one day again they're questioning us. So they keep going between these. And this is the only part where I have brought in a paper, and I have spoken more like a didactic lecture, but from here on, it is a complete practical experience from MNJ. And one thing I think is a huge piece of making everything fall in place is the leadership that we have when we want to develop a pediatric palliative care program. And here, most of you know Dr. Gayatri Palak ma'am. She doesn't need an introduction. And I think we are very, very fortunate at Hyderabad that she was, and she is still the leader of our program. And this goes a long way, especially when you have a very strong leader in forming very strong connections with the director, head of the institute, and even the oncologists at the hospital, who have to get convinced and who have to move beyond the stigma of pediatric palliative care being end of life care or a replacement of cancer care, or even sometimes giving up on those children. And even to get the commitment of the institute, not just in words, but also as we have discussed, having a space, having staffing, and this is a huge thing. And the biggest challenge, I think, when it comes to pediatric palliative care is it takes a lot of time. The returns are a lot of times not immediately visible, and these are value added services. So a lot of, I realize I'm saying a lot of times, but either way, we do have to remember that collecting qualitative data is equally important here. And this is something we have seen multiple times. And that is the triangle where we talk about education, drug availability, and implementation. And I would first like to deal with training and education. And when we speak about training and education, we are not just talking about training our own staff. It is also training oncology staff. And I've written nurses here before doctors, because sometimes it's so much more easier to get the nurses in one room than all the doctors in one room. And even identifying those nurses who are the leaders, sometimes the nursing superintendent is the one who makes all the decisions. But sometimes behind the curtains, there is a very strong nurse who might not be holding that powerful position, but she holds a very powerful position among the nurses. So this goes a long way, getting them on board, and even the doctors. And doing a lot of pediatric palliative care training by sharing experiences, again, sharing case stories and showing the impact that is done goes a long way. And also identifying and strengthening, empowering our staff to teach so that we alone are not doing all the training. And over the course of 15 years, these are the programs that have been developed at MNJ. One is 1 year fellowship in pediatric palliative care, which is a hands-on full-time fellowship. And this has been recently accredited by RCPCH, and 1 month observership in pediatric palliative care. And from 2018, we have been constantly doing echo sessions. We have done them for pediatricians. We have tried to focus on palliative care physicians. And currently we are doing one with palliative care residents in India. And interaction with residents at MNJ Cancer Hospital. And we have even a program right next door in a government pediatric tertiary hospital. And I'll talk more about residents as we go further, but this is something that becomes very, very important. And something I haven't mentioned here and that we are doing as a team is that we are part of IAP subchapter of pain and palliative care, three of us who work here at Hyderabad, and we are part of the academic body. And By being part of another academy, what we are trying to do is we are trying to take the learnings of what we have done in palliative care, specifically pediatric palliative care here, and we try to improve the delivery of training of pediatric palliative care there. And this is a picture where we talk about, I have spoken about 1 month observership. Here in the picture, we have two Bangladeshi trainees, one doctor and one nurse, who have come here to Hyderabad, and we have visited one of the district palliative care. And in the picture also, we have a Canadian doctor who works with the international part of our NGO, who has come here to teach them and to help us understand more about palliative care. And this is a picture of one of our echo sessions. And drug availability, I know this has been spoken a lot about in this platform. And one thing that I think we have successfully able to manage, thanks to again to our leadership and also our program coordinator, is that we have opioids around the year, and it's an uninterrupted supply of opioids. If we miss getting those opioids for that 1 month, having a number of patients close to 12,000 per year, close to 1,000 of which are pediatric, you can imagine the discord in the continuity of services if that happens. And I've written here 10 mg immediate release morphine, fentanyl patch 12.5, and syrup methadone, because these are very pediatric friendly preparations that we have. And One not so good thing I feel is we do not have syrup morphine formulation in India. Our neighboring countries of Bangladesh and Nepal have, and I think that makes it so much more easier to give it to children. But this is something I think we should work on more in procuring syrup morphine if we are going to see more and more children in our country. And then also ensuring that hospital has pediatric formulations so that it wouldn't become a burden to the families to keep buying them, especially this being a government hospital. And coming to policy and implementation, again, I'm not going to go into the didactic part of it, but something very specific that is being done here. Again, getting the buy-in of the state, that government of Telangana's commitment has been very, very crucial in the whole process. And palliative care is part of the state insurance package. So all the patients who get medication from MNJ through Aarogyashree, the insurance package, it is covered by the government. So the hospital doesn't have to take the complete brunt of bearing the expenses. And this kind of gives the buy-in with the hospital also, because they are getting compensated for the expenses. And then recently, we have recruitment of two medical officers at MNJ through NHM with 5 nurses. And this takes off a lot of a burden from the external supports that we are getting in running the MNJ program. And again, Telangana's commitment of having every district 1 palliative care center. And I'll come to why I'm talking about all this in pediatric palliative care. And we have also trained a lot of Ayush doctors, health and wellness center doctors, and PHC doctors over the last 3 years about palliative care. And again, because we are present here, we do exclusive sessions on pediatric palliative care, and we speak on some very common pediatric conditions that are seen in the community. And here I'm talking about all this because one thing we do is we network with the districts, especially for these cancer children who go home. So we call it takeover when the oncology department says there is nothing more to be done from our side. And the moment it is said, the parents want to take their child home, and even the child wants to go home because they're missing their family, they're missing the home, and even they're missing the physical place, the house. So when they do that, I cannot force them to keep them in Hyderabad, especially when their house is 300 kilometers away. So what government of Telangana has given me now through this network is that now we know these doctors, we know these nurses, and I make this one call and tell them that here is the child, so-and-so, so-and-so, and I give them the complete information, and I'm going to say they're coming into your area, and could you keep following them up? And our team follows up with the district palliative care center and also with the child. And this networking goes a long way. And especially when these districts, they attend to the child and they form a bond and they journey with the child till the end of life care, it makes a huge impact to them and it shows them what they're achieving, and that kind of keeps them going. And also one thing we offer from here at Hyderabad is that we tell them we can give you continuous support and virtual availability all the time to mentor, to provide better care, because a lot of these doctors are sometimes very, very uncomfortable with treating children because they don't feel they have enough knowledge. And this goes, I think we being available on the phone makes them more confident in handling this. And advocacy and awareness. I know we talk a lot of times about community. Again, through these palliative care programs, we do, the A&Ms do community awareness and also the survey. But one thing I have written here is residents, and I cannot stress enough on working with them and also working on them, right? Because residents, a lot of times, I don't know how it is in a lot of places, but at MNJ and also at the other pediatric hospital, the residents are giving me referrals most of the times because they are spending a lot of time with the patients. And also we have to recognize that these are the future practitioners. And also I never miss a chance, if I can, to dazzle them with some nugget of information, because they always want to learn and they're very appreciative of any time we take. So especially when I get referrals, if the residents are in the ward, I ask them to give me a short history. And when they do, the interaction that we have kind of establish a relationship, and this helps in appropriate early and meaningful referrals. So residents in cancer care settings, especially in a teaching hospital, never, never to be underestimated. And I just want to share a small incident that happened just last week, 2 days ago. But this is from a non-cancer setting. There is this child, 9 months old, they're suspecting immunodeficiency. And the child has been coughing for six months. And 8 days ago, I think 9 days ago, this resident in her night duty, which starts at around 2 o'clock here, they approached me and said, "Madam, there is this child who is coughing continuously. Like out of 60 minutes in an hour, this child is coughing 59 minutes. So you can imagine how distressed the child and the mother is. So can you help her?" And the resident herself suggested morphine. And you have to realize that they have never seen morphine 6 months ago before we went and we started this in the wards, pediatric wards. And I went, I assessed the child. The child definitely has infection, and the infection is being covered with antibiotics. And that being a weekend Saturday, and when I went to see the child was in the mother's lap, and the mother was sleeping. She was sleeping without any back support. I could see that the mother did not have any night sleep because the child was coughing all night. I had to wake her up, and then I had to ask her what was happening after the history. I started the child on 8-hourly, very small dose of morphine, because I was not available on Sunday other than telephone support. And we went back on Monday physically to see the child. And mother was profusely thankful because she said, from 6 months, we have been to multiple hospitals and not a single medicine helped the child. And I don't know what this medicine is, but this made a lot of difference to the child. And she kept thanking me, and she kept thanking me every day, the whole week. And last Saturday, she was in tears. And again, she was saying, because I had to increase the medicine, it wasn't helping the child so much anymore. I was titrating up the dose. And I realized that when she again gave all the credit to me, I told her that, please tell the resident about how this helped you. And please thank her, because in the night duty, she remembered you in a different ward and approached me, and she did this. And I think she went back and did that. And the way the resident started looking at me was a complete different way. And all this happened in a span of 1 hour. So here I want to say one thing: residents are definitely our advocates. And two is that feedback, sometimes immediate, sometimes that goes from patients, changes the way people and our colleagues look at palliative care. And this is all the more so in pediatrics because they definitely want to help, but they're not sure what the role of pediatric palliative care is. And then what is the buy-in? How are we even going to convince that we are an essential service and that we can make things easy and we are just here to help the patient? And one thing is, again, a lot of times government hospitals might not see that because they're not spending a lot of money sometimes. But I think in the corporate setup, when we have interacted with them, one way we made a point is that even identifying the burden versus the benefits of the treatment. So when palliative care comes into place, we are talking about what are the burdens and what are the benefits of continuing any given treatment, because we are always acting in the child's best interest. And these sometimes include chemotherapy, radiotherapy, ICU stays, even oxygen with face mask and ventilators and all these much needed resources. And they get caught up in serving the children who are not going to come out of it. And sometimes they're being troubled by all these interventions. And these interventions are no more available for that salvageable child. So doing all this changes a lot, especially if the hospital is seeing 1,000 children per day, 500 children per day, and even 50 children per year. If we're seeing so many per day, it makes a lot of difference. And again, any pediatric palliative care program as such needs a lot of financial planning. As I said, it's a value-added service. And one thing we have to keep looking at is the budget versus revenue. And when we are managing the whole program, we do have to remember that money has to be allotted for staff and equipment. And when I say equipment, I know it's not going to be fancy, but again, pediatric palliative care needs a lot of equipment in the sense that to constantly keep the children engaged, we are going to come more into that. And even having an infrastructure, having a place available. And also what is important is, what is it you want to do at your center? Is it just OP and IP, or do you want to extend into home care and hospice? And the more you extend, the more you have to look at your budget. And we also have to remember that even minimal things like the budget you're going to give for diet and the laundry, the medicines that you have to supply, all of this comes into play. And a good financial planning again goes a long way. Otherwise, if we have to look at the funding every 2 months, 3 months, it is going to be a lot of burden for all of us who are involved. And coming to staffing of pediatric palliative care, if it's the initial phases, we are going to start with the bare minimum, and we hope to expand every year. And again, a lot of it comes from the data we generate, the research we publish, and that helps us make a point. But the bare minimum, I think, is a doctor and a nurse, and very, very good to have a social worker, because due to some unforeseen reasons, I didn't have social worker for 2 months in the cancer setting that I work in, and I missed my social workers so much. They bring so much value. They connect to the children on a regular basis, and it is not that we have to speak to these children and families every day for 1 hour. Talking to them 5 minutes every day over a period of time, especially when you're seeing them even during the curative phase, goes a very long way. There is an establishment of therapeutic relationship with the families, and also the time management of just 5 to 10 minutes every day meaningfully helps us do our work more effectively. And the ones I've put in blue are fancy for me, because it's very difficult to get especially psychologists, play therapists, when we are looking at a budget, and volunteers. Earlier, we used to have volunteers, but because of the COVID situation, we had to limit them. And having occupational therapists, physiotherapists, and even child life specialists, all these people are add so much value to the program. But again, if we do not have the funding, we always can take the best of what they do, and we can do it ourselves, the doctor, the nurse, and the social worker who are already present. So it is good to have, but it is not a must have. And staff training. Again, having staff who are not competent in palliative care, including volunteers, is not a good thing for the program. They have to be competent, they have to be taught, and there should be an ongoing training that keeps going so that they feel good about themselves when they see a child, when they can do proper assessment and help the child. And I think it is the program leaders and who have to decide what is the level of competence that they need in each staff. And I'm mentioning this because over last few years we picked a case and her daughter, and as rehabilitation we have taken her into the program. Her level was 10th class, but over the years, because of the work she has done, now she works in the role of social worker, not at that level, but she can do most of the things a social worker does. So if we can help our staff achieve different levels of competence by concentrating and by encouraging them, even someone who is just 10th class, as we say, just again, I don't mean to put it down, but all I mean to say is having a master's as social worker and sometimes having a 10th class person also who is equally trained helps in the program, because they bring different aspects while seeing children. And also here, one thing that is very, very important when I say competent in palliative care, especially in cancer setting, and we have all these oncologists who can be skeptical sometimes about what we are bringing, because palliative care can be looked as tender, loving care. It helps a lot, again, to be knowledgeable about cancer. The treatment of cancer, the adverse effects of treatment, the complications that can be seen during treatment, and even the natural course of history. And so when I get an oral mucositis referral, I'm not just giving them morphine or some NSAID to help them with the oral mucositis. I'm looking at their whole prescription chart and looking at what could be the reason why the child has oral mucositis. Sometimes I go back and discuss this with the treating physician, and that is when I start the medication. And being competent makes a huge impression that we are providing serious medical services and we are not just there to talk to the patients, because a lot of times they put palliative care in a box that please come and do counseling. And to break that, I think it goes a long way when we go back and interact in the medical terms also. And again, staff burnout and self-care, I'm mentioning this in flow with the staff discussion. Pediatric palliative care is very, very intensive. It is very emotional, and a lot of times the staff struggles with emotions, especially when we have children of our own and we see a similar child at that age. It strikes a chord, and we can get very disturbed during the course of our work. And sometimes we end up crying and children cry, and over a period of time we get attached to children, and when they become unwell and when they are breathless and we have to help them, it can lead to a lot of difficulty there. Especially staff friction can happen among themselves, and also staff friction with other specialties. And I highly discourage this. So I am quite open on the first day of their coming to my service. I tell them, please, if you have any issue, please bring it up when we meet. Don't fight among yourselves, because as it is, this is very difficult work. And this is something I think, again, as palliative care leaders, we have to address. And then the other issue we have is staff attrition. A lot of turnover of staff and having to train off all of them, that itself is difficult to all of us. And to prevent burnout, we do have to let them express, and they have to be heard and their emotions validated. So over years, here what I've seen, what they have done is meditation was something that we have tried once a week, mornings in 1 hour. And we hope that it would pick up as a habit in general. And right now in our home care, they are doing yoga every week on the Saturdays afternoons. And in pediatric palliative care, I tell my staff that when you're playing with children, which is something which is a must every day that they have to do, again because of COVID, it has slowed down. When you play with children, make sure you enjoy and you also do things that you like. So if you're making children color with crayons, it's okay if you pick a crayon and color too as a way of self-care. So always, I think we have to keep reminding them to take it easy and to vent out and let out whatever is happening in their life. And team meetings, always have designated time and space to check in with your staff. And these can be sometimes just patient stories in the sense that discussing what could have gone better, what we could have done for this child and what can we do for this child, especially when there are some difficult symptoms that we are handling, administrative issues, sudden long leave of staff and things like that, and sharing how difficult it is or how easy it is or whatever. And then even discussing statistics, what is happening? Are our referrals going up or going down? How many deaths happened and how many of them could we support? And one thing I think we have to let the team do is share their difficult situation or experience, because self-experience, it is very difficult to take all this in pediatric palliative care and go and talk at home. And even friends of mine find it difficult to listen to the stories of pediatric palliative care. So I have stopped sharing as such a lot of what I go through. But when I find a child very, very connected to, or when someone makes me very emotional, I tell my staff in a way to validate what they might be feeling to that, I'm not feeling good seeing this child. It makes me very sad that this child is going through this, that this mother has to go through this. And I also tell them that I'm very, very grateful that I'm not in that situation, because that is what I feel at that moment. And I hope that they reflect upon it and sometimes open themselves and share the experience with us. And here is something which I talk a lot about to all the observers and trainees who come to our program. And I don't know how this would be received, because building relationships is a huge thing in pediatric palliative care. And a lot of trust is built in small talk between patient care. I've spoken about competence, being very, very medical sometimes and all that, but this is the other side of the coin. Just saying hi, hello, how are you doing? Looks like there are a lot of pain. Looks like there are a lot of patients in the ward. Looks like it is going to be a busy day for you. Even a lot of trust and even a kind of relationship builds between the oncologist and us during these small talk. And whenever I get a referral, I go back to the oncologist, maybe not every time, but at least difficult symptoms. And I say, what do you think is happening? Why do you think this child has so much abdominal pain? You know, I think 1, 2, 3. And sometimes the oncologist hasn't thought of the 3 or even the 1. And they're looking at the other things and you're putting these ideas in their mind. And they're also seeing that you are thinking about the patient, not just that you're going to come and write morphine and go, that you're thinking about what could be the differential diagnosis for the child. And a lot of times having this attitude of this is our patient rather than your or my patient goes a long way. And when someone is very, very symptomatic and we don't get a referral, we go and say, do you think I can help this patient? I think, you know, I can do 1, 2, 3 things and that would help the patient. And that kind of conversation would go a long way. And here again, I would like to share a story. There was a very senior medical oncologist at at MNJ, and she's not here anymore. She's practicing elsewhere. And this was the time when I came to pediatric palliative care, close to 5 years ago. I was very, very new. And people told me stories about her that scared me, and that she would never give referrals to pediatric palliative care, and that she's very hostile. These were the stories I heard. And I think for the first 1-2 weeks, I was just tiptoeing around her. If she was in the ward, I wouldn't go to the ward, or I would be doing rounds on the opposite side just to be away from her, because I don't know what would happen between us. And then what happened was, slowly over a period of time, I started saying good morning, and then she would say hi back, and she would smile at me, which I did not expect. And then I started following her rounds, because these were my initial days in a cancer hospital, and she started teaching me. And then in the rounds, she started saying, Spandana, I think this child needs morphine. Spandana, I think you should ask your social worker to speak to this child and spend some time with this child. So what I realized is, this was not that she was hostile to palliative care, or that she hated palliative care, or she hated me. It's that the case burden was so much, and that she was concentrating on just getting oncology treatment out there, that she didn't have time, or it didn't enter her mind that that child benefits from palliative care. But when I was visible to her, when I was with her, she saw a complete different angle of this, and she started referring. So our referrals went up, I could help more children, and I felt a lot better because of all this. And when I say here on the slide, updating and feedback, and what I mean is, especially when these takeover children happen, that is when the oncologists say, palliative care, please take over this child. This child needs exclusive supportive and palliative care. This child moves away from the hospital. This child is no longer at MNJ, because this child either wants to go home and is in our home care, or wants to go home, is in our district palliative care, or wants to go home and is going to a far off place like Maharashtra or Karnataka, and is only on phone call follow up, or this child goes to hospice, and so this child is away from the eyes of oncologist. So when anything significant happens, the child becomes better, the child worsens, the child wants to go home, or the child even passes away, I go back and I say, hey, I just wanted to update you. This child, that osteosarcoma child XYZ, whom you referred to me, is much better now and is going home today. And then if the child passes away after 3 weeks, I tell, hey, I just wanted to let you know that this child passed away at home. The child had mild breathlessness. They tried to control it with morphine, but it did not happen, and they didn't want to move anywhere else. Sometimes I do this in person. Sometimes if I know that I will forget because of other things, and I just text them. And I know all of this seems like a lot of salesman skills, and some of us can be averse to it also, but I think we are all selling something in a way, don't you agree? Something new to the world, that is palliative care. And this is where I think a lot of networking, a lot of fostering these relationships goes a long way. And even smiling at people, especially when we don't know, I've seen that it makes a lot of difference. And research, again, especially because we are all doing this for the first time, I think all work has to be recorded, measured, and I have a confession here. We do record, we do measure them, but we are not interpreting them, and we are not making a lot of time to publish it. I think that is because, again, allotting time for this. I think there should be some specific time when we are starting pediatric palliative care programs, because these are very, very novel in India in a way, because not many centers are doing it. We should make sure that there is some saved time, allotted time to spend on pediatric palliative care. And I think we should be encouraged to publish a lot of work, and especially when paucity of data is being pointed out. WHO has come out with new guidelines for children on pain, chronic pain, and they have mentioned in that that these are mostly guidelines, and they couldn't make more robust evidence-based guidelines because there is a lack of data in children. So if you're working with children, when you're working with children, always record the data, and even even the work with 10 children can be published because, again, there is a lot of paucity there. And collaborations for pediatric palliative care, I think this is very, very important. The cancer hospital that I work with, we have an MOU with the NGO, again, I work with, which is Pain Relief and Palliative Care Society at Hyderabad. And the MOU is that PRPCS, as we call it, supports various aspects of functioning, and they decide what they want to support. And right now they are supporting the staffing part of it, the home care part of it, which are huge budget for them. But having said that, even small things like crayons, juice cartons, because sometimes these children don't take anything else and they just want juice at our room, and even medicines, which families keep saying that, oh, we are going to get, and they don't get, and the child is continuously throwing seizures or having other symptoms, the society supports. And again, through the NGO, we identify the financially distressed, and the challenges, again, I think, like most of the programs, having a steady stream of help that we can keep doing for these families. I've added this that one of our van driver is handing over groceries to one of our patient's mother. And I know this is not the most important thing palliative care has to do, I don't know. But if the family is hungry, and I keep talking about, you know, please care about your other children, it is important that you look at nutrition. And if I keep talking about give syrup Levipil, give syrup Valproate, and only then there is good control of seizures. And you can see when you go for home care that this family cannot afford the next meal. I don't think we are doing enough justice in a way. And that is why I have brought this up, that and there are a lot of NGOs which come forward, a lot of individual donors who come forward, especially if they know that you're doing this good work. And again, this picture was taken to be sent as a feedback for the donor. Donors like feedback that whatever work that they're doing is actually filtering down to the grassroots level, that the actual ones who need it are benefiting from it. And pictures, audio, video testimonials, and even written notes go a long way there. And again, in collaborations, the NGO I have spoken about is a local program, whereas international collaborations go a very long way. Again, I think we are very blessed to have multiple international collaborations. And I think this is again through our leader, Dr. Gayatri, and well-planned training sessions for our own staff through these international collaborations. I know some of us are very skeptical in following whatever the best says as it is, but it is very interesting to hear their perspectives and adapting it to our own situation. And we have done some workshops over a period of time, and even having visiting faculty and sessions to constantly upgrade the skills, to constantly upgrade ourselves. And we have a collaboration with an international university, and their medical students come every year, and most of them do research in adult palliative care, but time and again we use one of the students to help us do research in pediatric palliative care too. So this is a picture. These are two of our regular staff, Kamara Van Bremen, who's a nurse practitioner, and Peter from Canada, he's Dr. Peter. And this is about serious illness conversation guide. This is something developed by Dr. Atul Gawande in the US. And what they have done is they have taken it and adapted it to pediatric serious illness conversation guide. And when they were here 2 years ago, we were all trained in using this checklist for serious illness conversation guide. And even though sometimes we don't use the whole checklist as it is, we use a lot of parts of it in regular communication. And we have seen that it helps us a lot. And one thing which definitely is very, very different from adult palliative care is play. And I've mentioned a play therapist earlier, and the intention of having a play therapist is to have a very formal play that can be done. And again, as I've mentioned, we don't have a play therapist. So what we do is mostly informal play. And if there is a budget, we can even hire a preschool teacher. and they can facilitate informal schooling in the hospital, wherein which these children are missing their school and they have this time in the day where they can sit together and they hear to this class, which is not formal, and they still are doing something. And I know, again, because of COVID situation, it is very, very different. But this is something to think about in the long term, that we all have a designated play area when we are starting pediatric palliative care services, which is accessible. I've seen it in Vijayawada. There is one at MNJ Cancer Hospital. And always to have in mind that there are going to be children with special needs and that they have to be handled too. So this was one picture when our nurse and social worker went out and bought some stuff. These are not very costly, but these are something we just give away to children. And if you give one of this toy away, you cannot believe the expression in their face and the way they react to you the next day, right? Not that they're hoping another toy the next day, but they know that you're going, you care for them and you are there for them. You make that connection with the child, sometimes even with the parent. And this is our cupboard stocked with all board games. And if you can see, there are some biscuits, chocolates. This helps in making a lot of connection with the kids. And this is our social worker at hospice playing chess with one of the child. As you can see, the child's right limb has a huge wound, was suffering at home because the wound was increasing and the family was not equipped to take care of it. They came to hospice for a few days, and in the afternoon when our social worker was free, this was their activity there. And this is another child. And the previous one, the staff is engaging them. And this one, the child is doing it themselves, that the child is coloring it and the child is going to do whatever they want. So play does not mean that you always have to spend that time, but sometimes having those small resources, they do it themselves. And I know a lot of you are going to say, we don't have the time to do that, but always remember, it doesn't have to be. Sometimes I do the play when my nurse is busy doing dressing. I make the kids sit. One day what we have done is we just filled a balloon, a single balloon, which must have costed 2 or 3 rupees. And the children were made to sit in a circle. And there were children, there was one child who was 6 months old, and then there were 2, 3, and they were up to 13 or 14 years, and all of them were sitting, and all they played was bouncing the balloon around, right? And the 6 month old was held by the mother, and she was trying to feed him because he was not eating in the ward. He was scared in the ward because that is where the IV infusions and IV cannula are put. She found a safe space for her child where he feels secure. And he was watching the balloon bouncing around and he started eating. So play doesn't mean that you have to do it, but sometimes you let the children lead. And this is one play. Again, as you can see, each one is doing their own activity. And again, this was taken in the COVID time. And I chose these pictures because I don't have to mask their identity. It was anyway masked. And then the other thing we have to remember when we are dealing, especially, this is very pediatric specific, is that pediatric palliative care is not just about the child, but it is also about the family and the siblings and supported by extended families. And sometimes the father has to go to work, mother has to take care of the other child, and the grandparent is the one who is doing most of the care. So grandparents suddenly have much bigger say compared to what we see in other places. So space and time has to be allotted, and even the way you talk to them is going to be different. And pediatric palliative care, the extension does not stop here. It also extends to school teachers, especially when they finish their chemo and they go back to school and they're being stigmatized. The teachers are the ones who are going to support these children, and even the friends. Sometimes these children are going to go back bald-headed. These children are going to go back darker than before. They're going to go back looking thinner than before, and even reaching out to those friends and teachers and even the larger community. So a lot of times these parents tell, no one in our village has cancer. We are the first family who has, and no one talks to us anymore. So even trying to reach out to the rural community through various NGOs, through various ways, and even having a conversation with the village head or school teachers, it makes a lot of difference for these children. And this should not be underestimated, because curing them of cancer or helping them live a longer life with cancer through palliative care is not going to mean so much if the family and the child is being stigmatized at the school, in their village, in their colony. So always remember that we are looking at the siblings, their understanding, and teachers and friends. And one other thing we do is, because we have a department phone, that is, we can make calls through that phone. Sometimes we ask the children, would you like to talk to your friends? Would you like to talk to their teachers? Because sometimes the parents don't have phone, or it is not free, or they hesitate to ask their parent, and we help them talk to their friends and stay in touch with what they believe is their, place. And here I would like to mention, especially about our program coordinator. Many of you know her, Ms. Vinila. But I think any program should have a very strong program coordinator. And this is to ensure continuity and even smooth transition of child from one service to another. I've told you our program has community, hospice, home care, IP, and sometimes these children even land in other corporate hospitals. And only because we have such a strong program coordinator, I think I can strongly say that we are able to follow up these children so well. And again, even to coordinate our needs, small things such as recharging the phone on time, procuring medicines immediately when some child requires, and even the necessary equipment. And she's going to be the point person who is going to do a lot of coordination. So again, if you're going to start a pediatric palliative care program, it can be an exclusive person, or it can be a nurse or social worker, or I don't know if the doctor has that kind of time to identify that, and that they are going to do most of the work. And even, especially I have spoken about staff taking long leave, staff attrition, turnover, and this is the person who is going to distribute the staff to us. So the program coordinator is in a way star of the of our program. And again, interacting with media, I've seen that recently, maybe because MNJ has, the program has been running since 15 years, haven't come into contact with media so much, but the other tertiary hospital we are working with, for less than 2 years now in neonatal and pediatric, close to 6 months plus. So now we are interacting with media, and we realize that the media is very, very impatient. They want that sound bite very, very soon, in a very short time. And I think we all have to be mindful of that. And we have to remember that what is that one message that has to go through, so that there is an awareness created in the families, so that the families come back to you and ask for you. And again, I think that is one thing in India we all have to work, is empowering our clients, empowering our patients and families, empowering the consumers of palliative care, the needs of palliative care from the other side, and that they demand that they need palliative care. Just imagine if a family goes and keeps asking, or if 10 families ask in a corporate hospital that, don't you have palliative care services? Don't you think that goes a longer way in the management's head, that there is something called palliative care, and that demand is there for that? And I think that is one thing we have to look into further. And I have allotted one full slide for this documentation, is because earlier I heard that a lot of people weren't allowed to document in the main case sheet. And what I think, writing in the main case sheet of the patient along with cancer treatment, palliative care treatment, goes a long way, because the oncologist is also looking at our notes, our medications. Sometimes I write the investigations on the side. Sometimes I even write a rule out 1, 2, 3, or the differential diagnosis of the present condition. And the oncologist and I communicate through these notes sometimes. And it is something that we have to look into and think about when we are doing this. And I just added these to say that we have to work on a lot of documentation other than writing in the case sheet. Here I have added a phone call follow-up sheet. This is something very, very homegrown that we have made. On the first page, you can see that the name, gender, the demographic data, and then we have written crisis plan. Do they intend to come to hospice or a center, or do they want to stay at home, or do they want any financial help the social worker is going to make. And on the front part itself, we have written date of death and everything, so that we know when was the diagnosis made, when is the takeover done, and when is the death happened. So you know the diagnosis was 6 years ago, takeover done 1 month back, and death happened today. So the child had 1 month, the family had 1 month to prepare for this death. Sometimes the takeover is done yesterday and the death happens today. And you can see on the documentation that it was not a good early referral. And then we have added whether the child is in home care or not. Sometimes the previous forms, they have said that the patients are not picking the call, the family is not picking the call. We started documenting why they haven't made the call, and even visits to the hospital and hospice. And then on telephone consultation, we have used ESAS-R revised, Edmonton Symptom Assessment Scale, and based on the date, we write 0 to 10. I don't know if you can see it so well, but below other symptoms, what we have written is who answered the phone call and when the next telephone consultation is going to be made, because these children are categorized into high priority, low priority, medium, and medium priority. So whenever a call is made, if the pain is 7 by 10 and advice is given on what medication to be given, I don't want my nurse or social worker to call them 10 days later. I want them to call the next day. So they write it here that the next telephone consultation date is planned on this date, and they have another register. It's more like a diary, and under the date they write this child's name, so that even though they go on a sudden emergency leave and someone comes to replace them, they just open the diary and see the child's name and they call the child. And these are the boards that we have. These are the patients that we see in different wards. And on the right are the children that are in home care. We had to do this because we are so busy with 100 other things, we tend to miss children. And I wanted to have all the children name on the board. This is the daily thing. And this is the overall program in a way. So on the left, we have children for takeover who are in high priority, medium priority, and low priority. And then we started identifying children who are high risk. That is, suppose it's a neuroblastoma stage 4 or even sarcoma with multiple metastases at the time of diagnosis. Adolescent who has multiple psychosocial issues. Children who can be abandoned by their family or who can abscond treatment. So I have written all this. So we have identified them as high risk, high priority, and then we have put them here. And they are in front of our eyes so that we don't miss them, following up these children. And then what we do is children in low priority, when they have symptoms, they immediately erase the name them there and put them in high priority there. And then we also have methadone form and a hospice referral form, which we formally use to shift the children from MNJ to the hospice. I've just added a picture of home care where our staff, as you can see, the left limb of the child has a huge tumor. I think this picture was taken quite long ago, my initial days in palliative care. And the social worker and the nurse are talking to the child, and the mother is quietly listening to what is coming up, the conversation there. And I'm close to the end of my presentation. And anytime we are going to start any services, we look at what is it that we want to do, the outpatient, inpatient, home care, phone call follow-up. I haven't spoken much about phone call follow-up in the terms of the time and the budget. So the phone calls are done from our center, mostly between 4 and 5. This phone is carried by the nurse concerned all day long, 24/7, 30 days a week, the month. But one thing that I wanted to say is we try to rotate it among themselves, again to prevent staff burnout, and they're compensated additionally for handling the phone. So the nurse who doesn't handle the phone for that month is not compensated, especially for the phone, other than the salary. And the nurse who carries it gets compensated. And the outgoing calls are made in specific times, mostly early, like 9 to 10, the initial hour of the day and the last hour of the day, because in the middle, we are trying to take care of children physically there. And incoming calls come all the time. But because our program has been exploding over the last few months, what I try to tell them is please call between 9 to 5 and any emergencies, please feel free to call after 5 o'clock. And then hospice. Hospice is very resource intensive. And I just want to mention that we have a functioning pediatric hospice, a complete different floor on top of the adult hospice at Hyderabad. And a lot of energies, a lot of planning have gone into it to make sure that it is very, very child friendly and that we use it only for children, both cancer and non-cancer. And again, district palliative care centers, the networking is a lot of time taking sometimes, but the benefits are very, very much more. And with this, I end my slide. I just want to say that the reality at the ground level, at the grassroots, can frustrate when we are very, very passionate and when we are excited to start, and especially if we are not well prepared. And like any other palliative care program, I think pediatric palliative care program, it's a long game. And if you look at this picture that I have put here, you can look at it as reality versus expectations of how you expect it to be and how real it is going to be. But I think after coming to palliative care, what I have learned is it is not glass half full or glass half empty. I'm just grateful that there is water to be, you know, to quench my thirst. So when I look at this picture, I just hope that this is more like an improvement curve, that I start with the head, but by the time I reach the tail, that we are going to be like this. We are going to fail at new ventures. Sometimes we are going to fail small, we are going to fail big, but I think the way we grow, grow in palliative care is only through perseverance and commitment. So with this, I end my talk. Over to you.
Excellent, Isminda. Excellent, I think. It was such a wonderful presentation. Beyond textbooks, so many compliments. I think, Nisha, all the compliments you should send it to, all the compliments send it to Spandana, and she should read all the compliments. It was such a wonderful presentation. Arun, please go ahead with the question answer.
Yes, thank you, Spandana. We just had one question. It's about when there is no local pediatrician or family physician for a child. How will the child manage such kind of a situation like end of life care with available medication? How can they manage?
Thank you for the question. And I have to say it is a very, very difficult question to answer, because even having this big district palliative care program, we struggle with it every day, especially when they go to places where there is no access to a pediatrician. But I just want to mention that there are very, very few pediatricians who are practicing palliative care or who even know palliative care. I think that is why we are working very strongly with the Indian Academy of Pediatrics to even mobilize more resources on that side. Having said that, what we have done in the past is a lot of times patients have access to even RFBs. I know we don't like RFBs, but sometimes we don't have any other option other than these quacks or uncertified practitioners of medicine. And as I've said, we have a department phone and we make contact with these people who are giving medicines, and we try and tell them. A lot of times they do negative things over there. They start the child on IV fluid and the child starts developing a lot of secretions. So we have this conversation, please don't start IV fluids. And they go to these PHC doctors and we tell them, hello, we are from so-and-so. I'm Dr. Spandana, I'm a pediatrician and I took care of this child. I know what the child is going through. Are you willing to have a conversation with me about how to help this child? And what I have seen is 99% of the times, the PHC doctor or even the pediatrician in a corporate hospital or even the RMP that I have mentioned are willing to talk to you and get back to you. But it takes a lot of patience from our side and willingness to be open to talk to these people. And the medication part, we try to send them with emergency kit. Sorry, I have not mentioned it. I don't know how it slipped my mind. We make a box with emergency kit We are not going to give any injection morphine, but even when the child has no symptoms, when we are discharging the child, I'm giving them 10 tablets of 10 milligram morphine, so that if they use this morphine at home and they see that it is helping, they send some nephew or some uncle of the child and they take the medication back. So that is one way. We give them medication to home. We follow a lot of strict measures there. We send medication. That is the other way we do it. Sorry, I know it's a long answer to a question, but that's it.
No problem. I think there is no single answer to that question. So absolutely okay. In the meantime, we have a few more questions coming. Like, people want to know your email ID. Kindly share that if possible. Other thing is that about training. How can people train with your program? That is one question that people ask. If you can.
Thank you very much for the interest. That is something I hope, because what I see is, I think it would take next 10 years to get more pediatricians to do pediatric palliative care. But I think what we should, even IAPC and all of us should start doing, is do a bit of pediatric palliative care on the side, develop a pediatric palliative care approach whenever we get children referred. And I'll just share my email ID. And I don't know if Vinila is still on the call. I have mentioned you about my program coordinator. And if Vinila is here, Vinila, can you please share our email ID too? So that if you please write to us, we are quite good. We send prompt replies on emails and we can connect. And based on the time you have, the needs you have, because we also do a lot of online programs and also hands-on programs, we can plan one. Thank you.
Okay, Sprinda. Anyone? Megan wants to say something? No?
not unless you have a specific question for me. But the 1 month program that we previously offered that we haven't been able to offer due to COVID recently would probably be something that many people be interested in. So we have a plan to do a virtual option for that program in future. But write to us and we have lots of programs.
So we have finished our time, but I want to say two things, Pandana. One is congratulations to an excellent team, Gayatri, Spandana, and Vanilla. I think you really make a excellent team at Hyderabad, and so many children and so many patients are getting benefited. So thank you very much for being such a strong team and inspiration for many. Second thing I wanted to say that Spandana has told so many practical points, but I know that every situation is going to be different in Spandana's life also, every child is different. So you have to just keep the principle of managing this child and principle of taking these challenges, how to handle these challenges, and just go ahead and keep on proving. This Spandana has given so many examples that when you keep on proving, people will start believing you, people start having confidence on you, and they start, you start getting their patients. So, and ultimately it is benefit for the patient. So thank you very much. And it was such an excellent overview of the challenges people can face and how to manage these challenges and the way, all the practical things, which I think textbooks will never tell you. So thanks a lot. Thank you very much. Thank you